I don't know what to say. Maybe we should open the mic up to Jesus, and he can say whatever he wants to say. Maybe we can ask him, what about the, eco-religion? It's striving to become the dominant religion of the planet. This is its goal. So, what do you have to say about eco-religion? Jesus is important. Maybe he will say neutral. I neither have anything to say nor do I not have anything to say about it. And this neutrality is very important. This is what I have always striven for in this world, is to try and to be neutral, but it's so difficult. It's just brutally difficult. The world is really full of extremely zealous partisans. And if you're not for them, you're against them. But truly, the religionists and the humanists, the eco-religionists, humanists, are two sides of one coin. Two sides of one false coin. But the partisanship is so severe right now, there's going to be a lot of animosity and hate involved. And what the world really needs is those people who are neutral, who realize neither one is right. So why should I pick one or the other? They're both completely wrong, mistaken. It's very difficult to do this. I'm having such a difficult time, and I really fear that if I'm not insulated from the world, I'll lose my neutrality because people are, frantic for some way to support for their position. It's the big. The truth is that the eco-religionists, they blame the world's problems on monotheism of Islam and Christianity. They absolutely do. And they want to get rid of them. They most certainly do. And one of the ways that they may want to get rid of them, I mean, it's not beyond the realm of consideration here, is to try to draw Christianity and Islam into some huge war so they just wipe each other out, severely decimate their strengths. That's something that is. Cannot be easily dismissed. If you look at the world events, you scratch in your head and say, what is going on here, really? It doesn't make any sense. So the eco-religionists absolutely would like nothing better than to get rid of the, what they call the paternalistic religions, whatever that's supposed to mean. And this is one of their major goals. The other is gun confiscation in the United States. There's no question about it. The Agenda 21 cannot reach its goals if United States citizens keep owning guns. This is the roadblock that they have. This is what is blocking them. Because they ultimately want to confiscate all private property, tell us where to live, confiscate our homes, our property, everything, and control our lives completely, where we live, who we associate with, what we eat, what we do, everything. But it's pretty hard to confiscate Americans' private property when everybody owns guns here with plenty of ammunition. So this is what they're trying to accomplish with all these various gun incidents. This is what, which is why there's a lot of people saying, hey, there's something, a lot of Manchurian candidates running around and trying to create a crisis so they can say, hey, we need to take everybody's guns, let's confiscate them. But their real goal is so that they can take over everybody's property. This is ultimately what the eco-religionists want, and they feel they're perfectly justified in doing so. And in fact, this is the only sane thing to do from their standpoint. Okay, well, it's difficult to take a neutral position on all this maneuvering that's going on, but I'm able to do it because I say this world is a scam. It's a dream scam. Absolutely, that's all it is. It's not a real world at all. And my position is that a real world, a true home to this, to us, we're the son of God, we're spirit, couldn't possibly suffer any injury or harm or be in any danger, ecological danger or anything. It's absolutely impossible. This has to be a fake scam of a dream, this what we call the world and human bodies living in it. Oh, we're wrecking the planet and all this, Well, so that's the ultimate right stance, is recognizing this is all just make believe, totally make believe. And the thing is that the eco-religionists who want to confiscate who really want a global socialism. There's no question about it. Okay, anyone who questions this has not looked into it. They are trying everything they possibly can to bring this about, a one world government with this massive bureaucracy controlling everything on the planet, thinking that this is the only way to save the planet from total destruction, and then humans from total destruction. There's no doubt that they are going to try and accomplish this. And there's also no doubt that there's a lot of people, especially the United States, the only country that's really standing against this is the United States, and the middle class, the non-elites of the United States. The elites all have their bodyguards, of course, who have weapons, but they're not. They say we do it. That doesn't count. But the people of the United States who love private property, private land. They say, "I want to do what I want to do on my land, my property. I want my house to be the way I want it to be." This is what's standing in the way. So these two groups are bound to clash. They've been clashing for quite some time now, and may very well continue to clash even more severely. So there is this polarity on the planet of severely polarized partisanship. And it seems like most people are in one camp or the other and are very, very partisan about it. So the conflict may be so severe, and the troubles and the hard feelings so bad, that when everybody has regrets and buyer's regrets and say, "Oh my gosh, I just feel like we messed up. We messed up. This isn't it. Earth worship isn't it. Angry God worship isn't it," too. They're going to want to get help. They'll be desperate for help, and at that point, they want it. Someone who's was not a partisan. They don't trust each other, and there's too many hard feelings, and it's better if they have help from those who were not part of the battle and the struggle and the partisanship and all that kind of stuff, who can come in and say, "Look, you're both mistaken. Two false sides of a false coin. Just back both of you back away, and start working on your continuity fear." That's all it is. It's just a dance of continuity fear. This entire world, with everything that's going on, is just a dance of continuity fear. That's all it is. So for me, I don't need to look at specific situations and judge anybody. I know what's causing it all. These are just effects that we're seeing in the world. It's just the effects of continuity fear. If we don't evaporate continuity fear, these effects will keep on dancing. There's no question about it. So, we've just look at history of the world avoiding the work on continuity fear, and just look at what the history has been like. It's a dance of continuity fear, and that will continue as long as we keep, avoiding that work. It's tough work. It's work, 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 work. And that's all it is. That's all it is. We just have to work at it. There's no secret except working at it, practicing, 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 practicing. And ultimately, familiarity, which is what wins in the end. Where our familiarity is, that's where our belief and intention and expectations will be. Okay, so if we don't get familiar with evaporating the continuity fear and working at it, then we will fail and fail and fail and keep on failing. So, it's not an intellectual thing that you get a right answer on a test and that's it. Nothing like that at all. It's a matter of gaining as much familiarity as you can and keep adding to it, like keep banking, keep putting deposits into your bank account. It's like it was 10:30 at night. I'm tired. Very tough week. I'm not inspired. But I said, "You know what? Why don't I go out and try to tape? Can't let the day go by." I said, "I can't just let it slip away. It's just you can't do it. You can't do it. You can't do it." This is the attitude. You just can't let the day slip away. And I try never to let a day slip away. And no matter how well you do for most of the day, try to finish strong in the evening too. Try to put on a finishing kick in the evening time. And you just do this every day, every day, every day. Find a way to focus on spiritual truth. You should spend your life listening to the sages and the saints and the enlightened ones and listening to what they say, pay attention, you know, spiritual practice, spiritual study, read the books, follow their advice. Somehow, whatever you're engaged in, whether it's reading or looking at pictures or, you know, put your attention on those who've woken up from this scam. Drop the scam, drop pretending they're something different than what they are. And just keep doing that. This is what really has to be done. This is the advice I got, and this is what I've done in my life. I spent my whole life putting my attention on the great sages and saints, and try to continually engage in that. Little spider's back. Hello, spider. Every time you're here, just like floating through the air, you're just loving it. It's quite incredible. I don't know why. Maybe it's just in bliss. Just, I don't know. The lights are on, and it's really something. You can't see it because it's too small. It's itsy bitsy spider. So this is the way. This is how life has to be lived. Responsible life has to be lived. It's pay attention. Find a way to put as much as attention as possible on the wisdom of awakening. You know, this is where it's at. And just go from day to day to day to day to day like that. Keep on paying attention, paying attention, paying attention. And you might say, well, you know, like for me, I say, well, I feel like the same as I've always felt. And there's been no really fundamental breakthroughs. Like, well, there hasn't been abidance. That's the fundamental breakthrough. I mean, I've had moments of abidance, but it hasn't, you know, not continuous. So, but that's true. So I say it just seemed like, just the same old, but still the same problems, etc. But familiarity is there. See, massive familiarity is there. Can't beat that. So you should always be working on familiarity. Whatever your habits are, that's what you're going to become familiar with. This is where you're going to end up finding yourself as you go forward. If you spend all your time, you know, focused on other trivial stuff, and that, this is what you'll keep doing. When push comes to shove, you'll go with what you're familiar with, and this world is certainly pushing and shoving. So the great gains don't really seem to show up right away, or eventually, you know, it will show up, and the scales will tip, because familiarity wins. Familiarity wins. You're overall, you've heard it so many times, focused on it so many times, truth, and it just becomes, you know, it becomes part of your belief, and your expectations becomes part of it. And so it's built in. So you're not wasting your time, even though you don't have breakthroughs. Don't worry about breakthroughs. Just keep working, 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 practicing, focusing, 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 focusing. If you're on the internet, look up the sayings of these sages, or what they said, or their pictures, or find some way to keep engaging with them. Always, always doing that. Keep bringing to mind how important it is, because so there's no secret really, other than hard work and working at it every day. That is the secret. And develop a neutrality, which is very important, not to become partisan, because both sides of partisan struggles here are total self-delusion. And I wish there was some spiritual Switzerland somewhere where those who are neutral could go and live. Right? Could go and live. So, and they wouldn't have to be tormented and bothered. I don't want to follow what's going on in this world, really, because at some point, you know, all has to be dropped and forgiven, and we need to move on to working on our continuity fear. So I don't even, who did what. It's kind of like, a spat in second grade. Who did what, and the teacher just says, "Hey, I don't even care. I don't want to know. We have some lessons we need to learn. Let's focus on that." So it's probably better not even to pay attention. Certainly don't want to get pulled into partisanship on either side of any issue here in the world. That is very difficult, because everyone that we're, associating with is very partisan, it seems like. This is a challenge. This is the spiritual challenge to go more and more and more towards neutrality, realizing this is much ado about nothing. It's really an attempt to convince God that this world and bodies, that this is God's creation and not spirit. And so, what is this? What? It's ridiculous. And they're just struggling over different narratives. The eco-religionists have their belief in the goddess and Mother Earth, and the religionists have their belief that God the Father created human beings in this world for us to live and have dominion over. But both these narratives are just two sides of the same coin of trying to convince God that this is what God created, not spirit, formless spirit. That's all that it is. So, it's kind of, let's say two insane people are arguing. Do you really need to pay attention to it? Or just wait until they finally wear themselves out and say, "Oh, I don't want to do this anymore," and then they'll listen maybe to what you say. Let's work on the continuity fear here, folks. Okay, but do you really need to go back over all the insanity? I don't think so. I don't think we need to. So we really don't need to know anything that's taken place here, because the goal is always to work on the continuity fear. That's it. If we don't do that, the insanity will continue, and the argument, insane arguments will continue. No progress will be made. Then we certainly don't want to referee the thing, because that's really stupid. But we're saying as well, I want to keep it even so that the best side wins. Well, why referee an argument between two people who are insane? Why referee that? What's the point of it? It doesn't help. It gives them the impression that there's a contest going on. There's no contest going on when two who are insane are arguing with each other. That's no contest. There's no contest going on with God. This world and bodies are not in some contest with God. Like this version of what God created is in contest with what God thinks God created, and there's going to be some winner, that's yet to be determined. There's nothing like that really going on at all. God is not the slightest bit interested in this scam that we're trying to run. It doesn't pay any attention to it. We hear Jesus say that God doesn't pay any attention to this world. And we say, what? Come on. No, it's true. Because this world is trying to convince God that this is what God created. This is God's creation, God's son here. This world and people and human beings and death and all this sickness and stuff. So obviously God knows this is not true. So God, there's no reason to pay any attention at all. God doesn't pay attention to it. Holy Spirit has already completely resolved everything. We just need to accept this, that's all. So we don't need to worry about what happens. There's nothing happening here. It's a scam. What happens in a scam if it doesn't work? Well, no, nothing happened. Nothing happened, right? There's no intrinsic value in a scam, actually. The value is what we think is going to happen. God's going to say, "Oh, gee, I guess I fell asleep and was dreaming that I created formless spirit, perfect freedom, but now I've woken up and I see, oh, this is what I really created, the universe with this world, worlds and bodies, birthing and dying and fighting, and oh yeah, this is what I created. This is what we hope is going to happen. God will think that God has suddenly woken up from a dream and seeing this now says, oh, of course. How could I forget this wonderful creation, of suffering and vulnerability and death and illness and conflict and fears. Oh my, yeah. This is how great oh gosh, how could I have forgotten it? How terrible. I gotta forget that wonderful dream I had of perfection. That was the dream of perfection and freedom and formless from. I gotta forget that. Yeah, who wants that? This is my wonderful creation here. This is our fantasy. We fantasize that God is like this. God can't wait to finally realize that this is God's true creation. And we're trying to give God every reason. Wake up, God, wake up. We're so happy, We're now eco-religionists, and we want you to know that we're just absolutely thrilled, to be here in the world and trying to make, worried about our next breath every moment of our lives. And it's just so wonderful, So wake up, God, and see what your true creation, how happy your true creation is. What are you sleeping for? Come on, wake up. It's really just like that. It's really just like that. Hey God, look at my new house. It's so wonderful. Look at me. I'm so wonderful. I'm the princess of the castle, and the world is my oyster, and I'm traipsing all over the world, and everything is so wonderful. And I'm a terrific person, and everybody, all my friends are wonderful, and we're so happy, and we're so blessed, and we're one with the Divine Mother of the earth, and the earth is what gave birth to us and created us, and and on and on and on. And so, how can you not realize that this is what was really your creation? And that other stuff was just some kind of weird fantasy that you need to forget about, and we'll help you forget about it. And so, this is what the world's about. Well, why pay any attention to that? As long as people are in that, spirits are in that mode, why even pay attention to it? There's much ado about nothing. So you have to repent. You have to repent, 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 repent. Yeah, I saw his bumper sticker. Woman's place is in the White House, or the House, or the Senate. The bumper sticker. This is a feminist bumper sticker. It must have been from 1970 or something. But it's people feel that way more now than ever, probably. Now, I should say, women's place is to repent. The same as man's place. Man's place is to repent. Woman's place is to repent. A woman's place is the same as man's place. Repent, 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 repent. Meaning, say, hey God, I'm tired of trying to hoax you. I want to give it up. Help me out. And then God says, yeah, Holy Spirit, here you go. And the Holy Spirit says, I'm here to help. Absolutely, I help to repent. To repent, help you repent. In fact, you've already repented, all the way perfectly. You just are honoring time, so you refuse to be aware of it clearly, because you still want to honor time. We had this crazy idea scam. It was over like that, and now we're just, honoring it by believing in time. Honoring it by believing in time. But it's really, our desire for it really ended, but we want to honor it, honor our creativity. So keep on acting it out in time. If something's already accomplished, why do we need to wait for it? How much time do we need if it's already accomplished? Already accomplished. So if something's already taken place, what are we doing waiting for it? Does that change the fact? If somebody said, well, we're waiting for it, does that change the fact that it's already happened? How could it change that? So we've already reached perfect abiding. This Holy Spirit has worked it all out for us. And yet we're still waiting for it. Like, let's say it passes 10 o'clock at night, and then it's 11. You say, well, I'm still waiting for 10 o'clock to come around. Well, it already came around. No, I'm still waiting for it. We don't need to wait for it. It's already happened. We're waiting for what has already happened. You know, this is honoring time. That's all it is, right? That's all it is. We're just honoring time. And it's a little odd. Of course, we realize it's already happened. You know, that nothing has already not happened. I mean, it's, you know, nothing has happened. That's already the fact. And yet we're still, you know, pretending that something has, waiting for nothing to happen. It's honoring time. All that we're doing is honoring time by doing this. The whole dance is just an honoring of time. And that's it. You know, so these conflicts, these partisans are just saying, how do we want to honor time? Well, you know, time never even started, but well, yeah, I know, but I just want to honor at least our fantasy that maybe it could start. So how are we going to honor our forlorn hope of time? And they argue over different ways to do that. The eco-religionists want to confiscate all our property, all our rights, freedoms, and stuff us in some cubicle in some huge metropolitan area. They want to depopulate the land and put everybody into the small area of these huge cities with massive skyscrapers and apartment buildings and you know, get everybody off the land. And so the earth can heal, you know, and then put everybody on some sort of house arrest, pretty much, so, and maybe starve a lot of them and depopulate the world. And, you know, clean up the world. So, you know, this is their way of honoring time. This is what they want to do. And other people, you know, want to do something different. We know how it goes, the partisans for both sides. But ultimately, you know, it doesn't really matter, you know, the narrative of the hoax doesn't really matter because the hoax doesn't work. And so there's really no point to it. And that's what needs to be focused on in the world, is repentance. So a woman's place is to repent. A man's place is to repent. That's our real place. Now, people say, well, it's too late. You know, the world's going to be ruined. There's so many people. Well, if people repented, it might be a very different story, actually, because we'd realize we don't even need this world. See, we don't even need it. And so, we could, you know, ultimately it would just disappear. And, you know, the question of is it being harmed or not harmed, it becomes irrelevant at that point. And it's seen as just a dream projection of our mind, spiritual mind, just a dream projection. But the world has not tried repentance, has not tried it at all. Interesting. You know, you go through, for instance, the eco-religionists, which is, you know, the United Nations, and the leadership of almost all the countries in the world, and all the think tanks. You can, you know, name many, many think tanks, many, many organizations. You know, you can try out all the usual suspects. You know, the Bilderbergs, the Club of Rome, the Committee of 300, the Illuminati. You know, all the, on and on and on and on. It's a funny thing that, you know, for instance, like in Club of Rome, with the membership is fairly known, but these they never include a religious person, scientists, business people, civic leaders, you know, various other things. Where are the bishops? You know, where are the pastors? You know, in any of these organizations, no, you have these intellectuals, Doctor so and so, you know, and some of I don't know why they think themselves so so eminent, preeminent. It's an extraordinary thing. And then you read what they say, and there's nothing to do with you know, religious-minded people at all. It's like they don't exist. It's very odd. Same thing with the United Nations and the agendas that they bring forth. Extraordinarily odd. I guess it might be Bishop Desmond Tutu or something like that. I don't know. Maybe he's a part of they may have one in there. But overall, and here's the funny thing, is they want to control our lives entirely, and yet no talk about spending our time in spiritual practice, religious practice, whatsoever. Now, doesn't this make everyone just a little bit nervous that people who claim that they have the right to control your every bit of your life give not the slightest bit of evidence that they have any interest in evaporating the continuity fear? Not the tiniest bit of evidence. And at that point, you just have to say, whoa, wait a minute here. Wait. So you're going to stuff me in a cubicle in some huge skyscraper and, you know, put me on, you know, soybean milk or something, and then you're gonna tell me to watch. You have to watch this amount of programming and social network with these people, and everything is controlled what you do. But there's not a, you know, what if I want to spend my time the way the Holy Spirit tells me to spend my time? I don't hear anything in any of these New World Order groups and think tanks, etc. I've never heard a word about the Holy Spirit, actually. Not one word. This sort of radically delegitimizes them, doesn't it? To an extraordinary extent. And I don't think we really want them telling us what to do and how to think and what our focus and attention needs to be on, because they've sort of, you know, completely delegitimized themselves by ignoring the voice of reason within us, which is the Holy Spirit, which is the only one that can really give us the truth. Okay? It's the only one that really knows the truth, because it's already brought everyone to salvation, the Holy Spirit, actually. That's the truth. So, you know, it's something that dawns on us, because it's so extraordinary. And you look at the great technology companies of the world, the internet and stuff, how they just ignore religion and their categories, you know, news categories, nothing for religious news, you know, interests, nothing about religion, you know, sports, entertainment, you know, science, technology, business, you know, relationships, nothing about religion, like it doesn't exist for them. This is a classic sign of somebody who's suffering from, you know, severe eco-religion, as you might say. Severe control freaks. They don't want us to say, you know, listen to the Holy Spirit. They want to pretend the Holy Spirit doesn't exist. You know, Holy Spirit deniers, you might call them. Holy Spirit deniers. They're suffering from HSD syndrome. Very bad syndrome. The fact there's not, it's so bad, there's not even any medication that you can use to treat it. The only treatment is for enlightened therapists to, help out and encourage them. That's the only treatment there is for this HSD disease, Holy Spirit denial disease. This is what they're suffering from. Yeah, because the continuity fear is just saying, no, don't even look here, it's too scary, don't even look here, let's just pretend it doesn't exist, this doesn't exist, let's just believe that the scam is going to work, and God's going to say, oh yeah, this world, and that's where it's at. In fact, they want to believe that this world, made God. What is that? Is that the spider? It is. You finally got here, spider. Where is it? I think it was. Okay. They want to say, oh, this world made us, and this world made God, and so they want. This is what they want. This is what continuity fear wants. It says, no, don't look at continuity. Don't look here, it's too scary, too scary, too scary. So obviously the Holy Spirit tells you to look there. He says, the Holy Spirit says, don't worry, I'll help you. So those who are in the grips of continuity fear, they say, Holy Spirit, oh, you must be some sort of religious maniac believing in the Holy Spirit. You're crazy. Yeah. Well, actually, they're the ones who are suffering from, there's a spider again. What's going on? Go back up on your tree there. That HSD, Holy Spirit denial syndrome. Yeah, there's no little pill. We can give you placebos. They mostly, what's a pill for it then? We got a new sickness. Great. What kind of pill do I need to take for that? I've got about 50 different syndromes right now, and I have another one that's wonderful. I need more syndromes. I can take more medicines. You can give them like a sugar pill or something. Give them a pill with some ground up Eucharist or something, or we'll give them Eucharist or whatever they want. Say, oh good, I got some treatment for it. That's great. Now I'm okay now. But at the same hand, you've got to actually listen to the Holy Spirit. And when it tells us to, we need to start working on evaporating the continuity fear, then that's what I need to do. And work at it, work at it, work at it, work at it. That's the only way to cure the HSD syndrome, is working on evaporating the continuity fear. The Holy Spirit is great. It's the greatest of the greatest of the greatest. It's so subtle, so gentle, so helpful, so patient. Just put your attention here. Just what are you seeing? What are you seeing? Oh, when we think, huh, I hadn't noticed that before. Isn't that odd? In fact, that's very, very strikingly odd. That has this been there a whole time? It has. How is that possible? I didn't see that. That's incredible. I wonder why my perception is so selective. That's bizarre. It's like, how many telephone poles do you remember seeing today? Think about that. How many telephone poles? Well, there are telephone poles everywhere. I mean, a lot of places, every yard has one, and like in more mountainous areas, there's a yard, the pole here, and the next house, the wires go to the next house, there's a pole there, and they get strung to the next house pole. So everybody has a telephone pole, but how many times do you actually see them? I actually saw one in this front yard of a place that I've been to many, many times, and I was like, did a double take. I said, what? Where'd that pole come from? It's been there the whole time. But we just automatically exclude it from our, awareness, because we say, well, what good is being aware of a telephone pole do me? I'm not interested in seeing. I just pretend it doesn't exist. But maybe God is everywhere, and we just pretend that God doesn't exist. Right? Just overlooking it. That's what perception allows us to do. Is perception is really an overlooking, is what it really is. The root of perception is the desire to overlook God. And since we believe that perception is our functionality, we're afraid to set it down. Well, we could say conceptually, well, I both am seeing God and not seeing God. Or we'll say, I'm neither seeing God nor am I not seeing God. When we, you know, it's just approach it that way as a practice. Yeah, I'm neither seeing God nor am I not seeing God. Because the shock when we see reality with the, not with our eyes of the body, but the eye of wisdom, is we're so shocked that it freaks us out. So we have to practice this way of diminishing the shock and make it neutral. Make it neutral. Just say, well, you know, I'm neither seeing God, but nor am I not seeing God. And this enables us kind of to ease in and kind of feel. It's like we're in a bathtub of water and we're afraid that it's like boiling hot. And it's really perfect temperature for us, but we've imagined it's boiling hot. So what we do is we say, well, it's neither boiling hot nor is it not boiling hot. It's neither boiling hot nor is it not boiling hot, which means I don't know what it is. And then when we get into this, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know, and are okay with that, then we're able to feel what the real temperature is. We stop imagining that it's something other than what it is because we're saying, I don't know what it is. So how could I say it's hot? I can't say, I neither can say it's hot, nor can I say, not say it, nor can I not say it's hot, right? This is an excellent, excellent practice. The Holy Spirit really has emphasized this with me to get to this kind of practicing of I don't know, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. Jesus also says when we can say I don't know is extraordinarily important. He says that means you're right ready for vision. If you can and not be afraid, if you say I don't know and not feel afraid or frightened, this is where it's at. This means you've made, you know, great progress and are ready for to find out what is, what experience, feel what is. Now the religious people, the private property people, these people, they do a lot of praying. They go to church a lot and they do praying, and they try to ask God, you know, for what is right with their lives. Except they don't ever get to this I don't know level. They always say, well, I know I'm a body and I know you created me as a body. I know you created this world. I know this, but I'm not sure what you want me to do with all this. This is not the I don't know that we're talking about here. Well, we can get to say, I don't know what I am. I don't know who I am. I don't know where I am. I don't know what my purpose is. I don't know anything. Okay, it's talking, this is about zeroing. I neither know nothing, nor do I not know nothing. I don't know where I am. I neither know where I am, nor do I not know where I am. Try to practice in this neutral way. I neither know who I am, nor do I not know who I am. I know neither know where I am, nor do I not know where I am. So keep practicing this. And essentially we're saying, I just don't know. I really don't know one way or the other. I don't have any partisanship. And then this allows us to open up to what we are. This is Jesus' central teaching. What he's trying to get us to is, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. And he says, just like saying, I don't know how hot the bath water is. When you can really accept that, then you can actually feel the temperature of it. So let's see, this is an analogy. He says, this is what works. This is what you have to get to. So I'm just advocating this practice and practicing myself as much as possible, getting familiar with it. And that's really the key. We just need to give up advocating what we think the temperature is and just keep practicing. I don't know what it is. And as the Holy Spirit told me, you don't need to advocate for what is. You just make sure you're not advocating against what is. And so drop at any advocacy, you know, for what is, and to go practice this neutrality. So I don't know. And this then, what is, will we will feel it then begin to feel it dawn upon us. Now this is the highest practice. So before that, you do assert, you know, you do assertions that you want. Say, I know, I am truth. I am freedom. I am spirit. I am this. I am. I am that. I am now. This. Okay, that's good practice too. It's powerful practice. But even then, beyond that, above that, is this neutrality practice, which gets to I don't know. And Jesus says this is the hardest. To get to I don't know without fear is the greatest accomplishment along the path. And then he says, you're right, you know, crossing the threshold into feeling what is. Now, I don't hear anything in the Illuminati's agenda, the UN's agenda, and all this agenda that has anything to do with this at all. It's like they avoid it entirely, completely void. It's like a black hole. They're advocating for the world. Now they're wrapping this up in this eco agenda, which, you know, I mean, you know, everybody, most everybody wants a nice environment. Okay, yeah, okay. I mean, but they're trying to use the this issue, you know, of Mother Nature to wrap up to legitimize their severe continuity fear, and they're ignoring what we our true responsibility here, trying to distract us from it. You know, they're really very, very intent on distracting us away from the Holy Spirit, and they're trying to hide this fact in all this, you know, eco babble stuff, climate change, you know, and CO2 resources, on and on and on. What they're really after is distracting us from the Holy Spirit. That's their objective. And it's blatantly obvious, you know, by what they don't say. If someone's listening to the Holy Spirit, they're going to let the world know about it, at least, unless, you know, the Holy Spirit says, let's don't agitate these people. But if they're doing some big public policy advocacy thing, they're going to say, hey, the Holy Spirit is the greatest teacher. It's the most awesome, wonderful discovery, you know, possible discover that the voice of reason is within us. It's within us. We have this voice of reason within us. This is extraordinary news. So we can actually practice and listen to reason, which is something that very few have ever done on this planet. What most people mistake the dance of continuity fear for reason. Because the continuity fear says it is. It says it's reasonable to avoid listening to the Holy Spirit because I'm too afraid to. I'm going to be annihilated if I do. So it's very reasonable to distract and avoid and defend. This is not reason because it's a lie. A reason cannot be based on a lie. That's the whole premise of reason is based on truth. But the intellect of the continuity fear is based on a lie. You know, that's not reason. They say, well, it's reasonable. Well, it's not reasonable. It's the opposite. It's irrational. Very irrational. So if, you know, if they have been truly listening to the Holy Spirit, they're going to say, hey, the Holy Spirit's wonderful. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Like, as I do in the videos, you know, thank you, Holy Spirit, for always being there and helping me practice reason and get used to reason and get familiar with reason. It's all important to get familiar with reason, not scientific reason. We're not talking about that. This is, you know, again, that's based on a false premise. Holy Spirit's reason is based on truth, of our continuity fear, that this is all a scam, what we're trying to do. It has no value. This world has no value to us whatsoever. It doesn't remind us of truth in any way, what we are. And we have this continuity fear. We need to evaporate the fear. And we will, you know, all this, Holy Spirit knows all this and helps reason us and helps us see through reason, you know, what are we really up to here and how to really... How can we evaporate the continuity fear? Whereas the continuity fear, if you let that take the lead, you never, it's just going to make excuse after excuse after excuse. The problem with religion is that they have all these premises. They say, well, these must be true because it's in the book or something. Some book said it. Therefore, they dictate to the Holy Spirit what must be true. And they say, the Holy Spirit, given all these premises that we know must be true, how can you help us out within this context? You hamstring the Holy Spirit by doing that. And then you end up listening to the continuity fear and thinking it's divine wisdom. Oh, yes. So again, two sides of the same false coin of not really paying attention to what the Holy Spirit has to say, not becoming skilled and familiar with reason, not ultimately getting to saying I don't know, essentially. The water's neither hot nor is it not hot. So we can still say it as if we do know. I say, well, of course I know. I know that the water is neither hot nor is it not hot. And it sounds like, the intellect, and we're asserting that we know. But what we're really practicing is that we don't know. Right? So it eases us into not knowing, which eases us into experiencing what is. This is the genius of the Holy Spirit. How to ease us into it. It seems like we're asserting that we do know, all the while we're asserting that we don't know. And that eases us past this continuity fear of, perception always being used to saying, that it does know and being wrong about it. We don't want to say, no, you're wrong, we're completely lying, they're wrong. That, we get defensive about that. So you say, well, the water's neither hot nor is it not hot. So you sound like, oh, wow, someone's very smart. I really know, what the water's like. But what I'm really saying, I don't know what the water's like. The water's neither hot nor is it not hot. What does that mean? Well, it means I don't know. But we're saying it in a way that makes us keep our sense of knowing, at least the form of knowing, but admitting, accepting that we don't really know. And we accept it. This is good enough for us. We say, well, we just want to hold on to the form a little longer, but we don't need to have the content there of really saying that we know. We can just say, yeah, I don't know. And we'll say it in a way, we say, well, of course, I neither know nor do I not know. So this is what Holy Spirit has shown me and is, helping recognize this, the effectiveness, of this. It's tremendously effective. We do not want to attack anything, put anything down, condemn ourselves, or anything like that. That doesn't help with the continuity fear. Continuity fear, we need to be very artful and very compassionate in how we deal with it. And say, okay, let's keep the structure of statements and knowingness, etc. But let's just, zero it out. So we're really saying neutral definition of the definitional neutrality of what I don't really know. I don't know. If I say, well, sure, I know that the water is neither hot nor is it not hot, that means I don't know what the water is, right? It's just that it's a way of saying I don't know indirectly. Indirectly. It's too tough for us to say it directly. I have no idea. I just don't know. I don't know. It's too scary. It's too scary for us. But we can say the exact same thing indirectly, and it's not nearly as scary. Not nearly as scary, is he? And so this is the wise way to go. And, you know, continuity fear likes this, says, hey, this, I like this, I like this. I thought I'd hate the Holy Spirit, but I really love the Holy Spirit. That's great. It's just ignorance, though. That's the problem. It's the ignorance here. Which is, of course, by design. They want to make us all supremely ignorant. And you know, you could say religionists have done that too, because they say, no, we already know the basics and all this stuff. We're just trying to iron out a few little details here. Don't anybody dare say otherwise, or you know, off with their heads. This is terrible. So what's the difference? I mean, they say we're sure about all this stuff. We know all this stuff for sure. But we say, hey, why not just say, let whatever is dawn upon us through a neutral mind, open mind. We're not trying to dictate reality, what we think we know about it. Because it doesn't need that. It doesn't need our affirmation, our acceptance, to be what it is. This is what reality is told me and shown me. It doesn't, truth does not need to be affirmed as true in order to be true. It doesn't need any affirmation. It doesn't need support. It doesn't need anything. It is true and remains true. So we don't have to say that we know what reality is. We don't have to take that position. It's not going to hurt reality's feelings. You know, we say, I don't know. It's very, very crucial. Truth does not need us to say that it's true. We do not need to affirm it. We do not need to champion it. Don't need to assert it. We don't need to say it. It's not required. It doesn't need it. It always remains true. God knows what is true and always remains true. It doesn't need us to agree with God. You don't have to agree. Say, oh yeah, okay, truth is true. And God says, oh great. Because if you didn't agree, it wouldn't be true. No, it's not like that. Now is now. Whether we agree with that or not, it doesn't matter. It's still now. All of now is right now. And there isn't anything other than now. So what does it matter whether we agree or not? It doesn't change the fact at all. It doesn't change the facts of reality one bit. So it's best to just to be neutral, definitionally neutral on it, which means then the way that it is, we will be able to feel it. It won't shock us, because really, since our position is I don't know, why would we end up being so shocked? You see, it's much better to say I don't know and just have an open mind. So when we feel it, say, oh, okay, oh, so that's it, great. Whereas if we're partisan and say, no, I'm sure the water's really hot, it's boiling hot, and then when you start to feel that it's perfect temperature, you say, wait a minute, you know, I'm being tricked. What is this? You're shocked. And it says, what's wrong? I thought it was hot. Now I'm all confused. You know, I'm worried. I'm frightened. What problem? It's a problem. It's a problem. But if we just say, I don't know. I don't know what it is. Then it's much easier to say, oh, so this is what it is. Okay, great. I'm glad to know what it is now. I didn't know before. I've forgotten. I've been in denial. Easy, right? Much easier. Much easier. Much easier to do it that way. So we can say, I neither know the truth nor do I not know the truth. I neither know what is nor do I not know what is. And just reside in that, just abide in that. And this is a calm mind. It's a mind with definitional neutrality, which allows us to experience the fact that actually what we are can never be defined. So it's tough to go from insisting that we have a whole bunch of definitions of what we are to experiencing that we cannot be defined. It's very tough to make that leap. It's much easier to go for, well, I don't know whether I can be defined or not. I don't know what I am. I neither know what I am nor do I not know what I am, which means I don't know. Then it's much easier to experience, oh, I cannot be defined. Oh, okay. This isn't like then interrupt, disturbing some definition I had of myself, right? If you've already practiced this definitional neutrality, you're not defending some partisan position, some partisan definition, some definition. You're not defending anything. So it's a way of setting down our defenses by, and save face at the same time by acting as if we're not setting them down. And that satisfies our continuity fear, you know. It enjoys this. It says, ah, thank you very much. At least I have something, a bone to chew on here or something. At least a promise of a bone, or if I needed one, you know, I might be able to get one. So, sure, I know what I am. I know that I'm neither am nor am I, nor am I not, or something like that. Sure, I know. I neither know the truth nor do I not know the truth. See, I know what I'm talking about. I know, and yet, it's puts us in neutrality, which enables us then to find out that we are not something that is defined as a product of definition, cannot be defined. So it's very simple here, but very artful. That's the art of easing past the continuity fear and satisfying, you know, its demands, making a deal with the continuity fear. Now, is that what the UN is, the United Nations is all about? Hey, if it is, I don't see any evidence of it anywhere. They said it's supposed to be evidence-based or everything. Well, there's a lot of the evidence is that there is no evidence that this is what the UN's about. Agenda 21. UN's just a, you know, front group for these other groups, actually. Now, I'd like a beautiful home environment, etc. But, you know, we're never going to get it as long as we let continuity fear be driving us. We'll get it by saying, I neither know what my home is like, nor do I not know what my home is like. Neither know what I want, nor do I not know what I want. And keep practicing this neutrality, and then our true home will dawn upon us. That's how we get it. That's how we arrive home. We don't arrive home. That's how we be. It's like you're in the bathtub. You don't arrive. Say, oh, I just arrived in this warm bathtub. I was in a hot bathtub, but now I've just arrived in a perfectly nice warm one. It's just perfect. No, we were already in the warm bathtub, just dreaming that it was scalding hot. So you can't say, well, I just arrived there, but I became aware. I became aware of what is always the case. I became aware of this. How are we doing here? Oh, we went over the hour. That's great. I got a lot of back issues right now, so I have to kind of move around. It's not good at all. This is the problem of swinging a golf club. It can really wreck you. It's not good to swing it too much, that is for sure. I forgot about that. Minimum. Don't put your body under that kind of strain. I neither know abidance, nor do I not know abidance. I neither know abidance, nor do I not know abidance. And just keep practicing this. And so you become very, very, feel just neutral about, you know, everything, these issues, just neutral. It's not a vacuum like some horrible emptiness. No, it's a very positive neutrality. You feel very positive. You say, wow, I feel like I'm making a deal with continuity fear here, which is fantastic news, you know, the best news ever. Like, wow, just think, I won't be suffering from continuity fear anymore. You know, how cool is that? That's the most wonderful news. So I said, well, I neither know where I am, nor do I not know where I am. I neither know how I truly feel, nor do I not know how I truly feel. I neither know truth, nor do I not know truth. I neither know truth, nor do I not know truth. Ah. And this does not interfere with your enjoyment of ordinary life at all. It doesn't. But what you're developing is a familiarity that will lead to abidance, because you're able to just allow what is now without shocking, you know, causing too much of a wow reaction. I watched a baseball game tonight. I said, I gotta watch this game. I gotta watch the Dodgers lose. Every Giant fan is rooting for the Mets to beat the Dodgers right now. And they beat won the first game. It was great. Very good game. Yeah. That's part of the rivalry. The Dodgers and Giants, and neither side wants the other one to win the World Series. And certainly don't want the Dodgers to win. But it's a good natured thing, you know. If they win, they win. But we certainly don't believe they will. So you can still enjoy, you know, the silly little stuff of situation here, to some extent. But it's not that big of a deal. But it was a very good game. Very good game. Great pitchers. So we have a blueprint for the future, which is to do these kind of practicing. That's the real blueprint for the future. But so we'll keep doing it. We'll keep doing it. We don't really need to worry about the UN and their thing, blah, blah, blah. You know, we'll just keep doing this practice. And of course, we need to hopefully get some results, the results of abidance. It's the one result we were looking for. Soon as possible, because the other folks are hell bent on stirring up trouble. They seem to like crises. It's part of their plan. Softens everybody up, makes them all stunned and apathetic. It's like pouring smoke into a beehive. But on this, also, but I'm not judging or condemning anyone here, in fact, because everyone is perfect standing in God. This is absolutely true. The Holy Spirit has led everybody past the continuity fair already. So it's just that they're honoring time is all they're doing, and doing that dance of honoring time. Ultimately, they really have a continuity fair. They think, if I stop pretending, I will have no function. This is the problem. If I stop pretending, I won't have any function. If I stop trying to scam God, I won't have any function. So I'll be nothing. And so they say, I'd rather have this crazy function than no function at all. Because most of us know that we're acting insanely. But again, we'd say, I'd rather be insane than not exist at all. That's a pretty lousy choice, right? You can either be annihilated with no existence, or you can have existence but you're insane, you know, so which one do you want? And we say, well, I will take the insanity, you know, try to put a bow on it somehow, put some lipstick on it and call it good. And everyone's dutifully playing the game, you know, trying to make the most of it. Well, let's make the most of our insanity. Oh, sure, you know, this is all so attractive, even though we know it isn't at all. And as you wake up to this, you realize the world's not attractive, really. Especially people are not attractive. It's like, what in the world? Are you kidding me? But everyone, you know, plays the game like, oh, yeah, we're all so attractive. And I'm attracted to you, you attracted me, we're so attractive, this whole scam is so attractive, insanity is so attractive, because we're afraid if we see how unattractive it is, we'll say, ah, I don't want it anymore, and then we'll have no function at all, and we'll be, you know, nothing. This is our continuity fear. But yeah, people, we do know. Everybody knows. This is insane. This is this world. Everything is so unattractive here. It's just horrible. We know it. We know it. We know it. We know it. And many have moments of honesty, saying, "Yeah, this is just like, you know, completely crazy here." But what can we do? We got to play the game. That's the only thing. We got to play it. We got to. It's either that or nothing. No, remember, we don't have to, it's not either or, it's neither nor. We can play the neutrality. Neutrality isn't nothing. See, it's not nothing. Not really. There's still the form of asserting neutrality. Okay, so it's not nothing. So we, as long as we're asserting this, you know, I'm neither this nor that, we have this form of assertion and expression. And then from that we realize that the isness is not annihilation or nothing. It's everything. It's the allness. So we just have to keep getting familiar with this, and it keeps feeling like, oh, this is just basic knowledge. This is just basic understanding. This is very simple. There's no trouble. It's an art to it, because the wow comes up. And we forget what we were saying before. Then we get the jitter, saying, oh, wait a minute, maybe it wasn't true. I forgot. No, it's the wow. If the wow comes up, temporarily renders us, you know, shocked. And we can't remember what the heck were we talking about. But that's okay. You don't panic then. You say, great, that means I'm making great progress. Let me just be patient with this. I know my progress momentum will continue on, no question about it. Great days here in California. I don't know when I have not said that. Beautiful, beautiful, gorgeous days. October has been incredibly nice. And it's supposed to continue that way and get even hot. But we wake up every morning to what? To our continuity fear. This is what we wake up to. And the madness of everybody else's continuity fear. The absolute madness of every, you know, distracting us from our practice and the Holy Spirit. And this is what we wake up to every morning. So you gotta be kidding me. The world's still this way. Oh gosh, I thought maybe it would change. It's never changed. It hasn't changed at all. The more that the world keeps claiming it's changing, the more it's staying the same. Spiders still going up and down. Maybe he'll just keep doing that. Maybe this does this all night. Maybe this is like the very essence of bliss. Just hangs in the air, just enjoying the air currents. Doesn't seem to be engaged in any other activity. Doesn't seem to be doing anything purposeful at all. Not building any web. What's it doing? I don't know. It just goes up and down. Comes down from the plant, hangs out for a while, and it just climbs back up and then goes down. But it's not building any web that I can tell. And it's so light, it seems to almost float in the air. It's so light. It goes, it's starting to move up again. So yeah, just a full stop in the wow. You don't have to remember what you just went through. You know that you did good practice. You don't need to doubt it. You know, at some point you're going to say, wow. It's like eating. You say, at some point, you say, that's enough, right? When we're eating, we don't just keep eating continuously. At some point, we say, wow, that was a great meal, but if I take another bite, I'm going to feel sick. So I better stop right now. This is similar to that. That's why Jesus used the metaphor of a meal for spiritual practice. The Last Supper is really a metaphor for spiritual practice. You know, do this in remembrance of me, meaning do spiritual practice in remembrance of me. It's similar to a meal. You eat and you take your time at it and you let it digest and eat some more, let it digest, have another course, let it digest. And then ultimately, you reach a point where you just say, wow, I'm complete, I can't take any more. And then it's time to just, you say, it's okay. All right, great. And be patient and calm and relax with it. Getting the eye on the spider. Was it going up? There it goes. It's going. Maybe it has a web down here, does it? No. See, it's not leaving any. It's not leaving anything down there. It just. I don't know what it's doing. It's completely white, and almost like transparent. So when you do a good spiritual practice, really, oh, it made it up there to the leaf. Boom. How about that? You feel like you've done a great workout. It's a great workout, and then say, okay, at some point you say, okay, I know it benefited me, my familiarity. Don't struggle, what did I say? What did I say now? Just better be grateful, get an attitude of gratefulness, saying, I know. I've already succeeded. I can, I will. I've already succeeded at abidance. Abidance is a done deal for me. Look at it that way instead of struggling. Abidance is already a done deal for me. No question about it. And it just hangs out somewhere. Oh, on the leaf there. Okay. It's just hanging out on the leaf before it parachutes. Maybe it's like an adrenaline junkie, like a what are you, a base jumper, some kind of base jumping spider. It just love is just let go into the air and then hang there in the bungee cord for a while, and it's the original bungee cord right here. Interesting. Younger generation likes to run and leap off cliffs and bridges to their death, and only they want to simulate, going off a cliff. pretty strange. They say, well, I got a bungee. I like enjoy this adrenaline rush. But was that true? Or does it reveal something deeper? That they're here to, you know, fling themselves off a cliff and everybody else off a cliff. There's nobody in my generation really who's, very few who are into that or even interested in it. I'm not interested in that. There's a few, you know, thrill seekers and stuff, but nothing like the younger generation where it's, you know, everybody's into it. Seems like so many. Sort of like sort of a commitment to a death wish, sort of commitment to death, seems like. They're just waiting for the right time when they can fling the whole world off a bridge. Or maybe the, you know, there's something odd about it, as to say the least. It's more than just getting adrenaline rush. I mean, that's just crazy. It's like they see their death, you know, coming towards them, of course, in the last second somehow. They, you know, avoid it or it doesn't happen. But it's simulating it. A lot of video games, you know, simulate, you know, death and all this kind of stuff too. Very strange. But not unexpected or surprising. It's, again, the dance of continuity fear. It's like they want to feel endangered and threatened. The world's not threatening enough for them. They need to artificially generate artificial threat with video games and base jumping. You say, oh my gosh, there's not enough vulnerability and death here. You know, I feel too safe. Holy cow. Well, let's stir it up. You know, they hate the boring middle class life. Oh no, I want to feel vulnerable, threatened. Like death is staring me right in the face and it's just about ready to get me. I gotta, you know, this is what they like. Makes them feel safe from the Holy Spirit, right? From truth. It's a defense mechanism, very strong defense mechanism. So hopefully this practice of, you know, this very intelligent, wise practice of pretending to state a definition, but really saying, I don't have any definition. I don't know. Well, you know, is going to eventuate in abidance. I don't really say it. I'll say it and don't say it. But this, you know, it eases the way for us. And we'll find out from that, you know, how to stay neutral. Nonpartisan. Stay in abidance. Don't get pulled out trying to help one side or the other of falsity. And we'll find out, you know, how do we stay neutral? How do we stay neutral? Is it possible? Here? Is it possible? I don't know. We can say, well, it's neither possible nor is it not possible. Keep practicing. Don't try to get answers. It's better to practice neutrality than to try to get answers. Because then we'll find that the answers will be aware of them. They're just like, oh, they're there. So don't struggle directly for answers. Practice this neutrality, definition of neutrality. And then whatever the answer is, it's not going to shock us much because it's not like it's the polar opposite of what we expected. Since we're taking definitional neutrality, nothing can be the polar opposite of what we expect. Right? Whatever it is, we're not going to be polarly opposed to it. Or we're not going to be partisan against it for sure, right? So it lowers the fear level greatly for us. We know we're not going to be partisanly opposed to it. It's the spider getting ready. It's getting ready to go again. It's going to the tip of the leaf right now. It's getting ready to base jump right now. I want to watch it. It's right at the end. I think it's attaching its bungee cord right now to the tip of the leaf. And it's ready to parachute. Come on. It's ready to leap. 3, 2, 1, go. It's got its doubts saying, gotta make sure everything's attached here properly. Three, two, one. Okay, step back. Take a deep breath. What is that? There's another one. There's another one here. Okay. There's a second one there. Just cooling down here, cooling down. This is very important to have this follow-up period where we cool down. And after going through, you know, very great intensity, talking about this, practicing this, and you know, it gets us, well, we're going to try to remember how we felt. We just feel, how we feel right now is that we're able to be in the wow, calm down from it, and then the momentum will be there for us later, and we'll do it again. And just every day you keep on doing this and doing this, and you find that you're familiar and more calmer and easier. It's like that. Don't struggle for a result. Don't struggle for a result. Just keep practicing. Okay. And we'll see what tomorrow brings. Be positive and gratitude, full of gratitude that my success at Abidance is already guaranteed. There's no question I'm going to be, you know, do it flawlessly. No question about it. Stay in that mindset that it's something that's already been accomplished. It's only a matter of accepting that's already been accomplished. It doesn't have to be. We don't have to accomplish it. We merely need to accept that it's already been accomplished. Okay. All right, great. That's it for this one.